Hello everybody, my name is Tom Tirer and I'll present our work on kernel-based smoothness analysis of residual networks. Let's start with some introduction and motivation for the research question. Basically, we all know that deep neural networks have led to major improvements in various fields. These improvements may be related to using novel networks architectures. One classical architecture is the multilayer perceptron, or MLP, which is a plain feed-forward network with fully connected layers. Here you can see, for example, an MLP with two hidden layers. The structure of the MLP can be mathematically formulated as follows, where capital L denotes the number of hidden layers, X is the d-dimensional input, and F is the output. Theta includes all the weights that are learnable. G is the pre-activations, and phi is the nonlinear activation function, typically ReLU. Sigma W here is the hyperparameter that scales the standard deviation of the weights, which are initialized using standard Gaussian random variables. Note that the small n is the width of the hidden layers, meaning the number of neurons in the hidden layer, and 1 over square root n that multiplies the weight can be observed in their initialization as typically done in practice. A major leap in the performance has been obtained when by deep residual networks, ResNets. ResNets use skip connections, which are identity paths in the network that add to the output features of a given layer its input features, as can be seen here for a network with two hidden layers. A mathematical formula for a ResNet model can be obtained like this, where here you can see the skip connection in each of the L nonlinear layers. Compared to MLP, we also have here the weight matrix U that maps the input X to the high dimension in which the residual blocks must be, and also the weight matrix V that will simplify our analysis. The hyperparameters sigma W and sigma V scale the standard deviation of the weight. And alpha here is a hyperparameter that will be imported in our talk. It weighs the residual block. All these hyperparameters are typically set to 1. Over the recent years, different works try to explain the advantages of ResNets over MLPs. Most of them focus on optimization issues. However, we observed another distinction between ReLU-based ResNets and MLPs in different regression experiments, where both of them have perfect optimization, meaning that they interpolate the training samples. Namely, we saw that ResNet promotes smoother interpolations than MLPs. Note that smoothness of the output is interesting property because there are several works that connect it with generalization. Here is an example of the observed behavior with interpolations of MLP in blue and a ResNet with different value of alpha, the hyperparameter that scales the residual block. Here it equals to 1 and here it equals to 0.1. And all the settings here are similar to those used in practice. The white is only 500 neurons and the optimizer is Adam. And you can see that the curves of the MLP is less natural. The curve of the MLP interpolation is less natural and also less smooth. Perhaps this is something that the difference is clearer when the number of samples is smaller. Like here, again, you can see, for example, in the left image, that the interpolation of ResNet is smoother, especially when alpha is quite small. Our goal is to provide explanation for this behavior. We choose to examine it using the neural tangent kernel approach, which considers extremely wide networks. If we take the number of neurons n to infinity at initialization, then each preactivation is a stochastic Gaussian process that we can denote by KL plus one, the covariance of the output of a L hidden layer network, which is, this is called basically the GP kernel. And similarly, the NTK can be defined as the inner product of the derivative of the output with respect to the parameters for two different inputs, assuming infinite wide. Under mixed conditions, it can be shown that the empirical NTK at initialization converges to the limiting NTK. The significance of the NTK compared to other kernels is that under appropriate conditions, it can characterize training deep neural networks with gradient descent. To see this, let D be the training set and L a loss function, and consider learning the parameter theta by minimizing the empirical risk using gradient descent. In continuous time, this can be written like this. And in function space, this can be written like this. Both just use the chain rule. Now, the key property is that under appropriate NTK conditions, this term here converges to the NTK Gram matrix, so that the complex dynamical system turns into kernel regression. And for L2 loss, it also has a closed form solution. Note that previous works derived the GP kernel and the NTKs for MLP. I won't get into these expressions, but note that they are recursive and that the terms T and T dot depend on the activation function and have closed form expression for values. Our first contribution is deriving the GP kernel and the NTK for our ResNet model. We know that the model structure allows us to use general results for the existing of the limits. And our results resemble those of another recent paper, which considered a similar model, but with fixed weight at the first and the last layers. Yet we also proved the stability of the ResNet NTK during training, which does not appear in earlier works. Without getting into details, this is the formula that we got for the GP kernel. And this is the complicated formula that we got for the ResNet NTK under mild assumptions. I will not parse them here, but rather jump to the stability results, which is given here. Basically, this result shows that under few assumptions on the training samples, such as non-repeating samples, we have that gradient descent with small enough learning rate obeys the following properties with high probability. The first line here implies convergence to zero training loss. The second line implies the stability of the weights during training around their initialization. And the third line shows the stability of the NTK match, of the NTK Gram matrix. Importantly, note that these results hold also for finite yet large white n. I'll just note that we also verified our NTK results, where we saw agreement between the analytical results and the empirical results, but I'll skip the details due to lack of time. So now we turn to compare the smoothness of the NTK and MLP, of the ResNet and MLP in the NTK regime. We start with comparing upper bounds on the norm of the input-output Jacobians, which can indicate smoothness. Basically, it's not hard to get the following expressions. Note that we need to upper bound here the spectral norms of the weights after training. While it's not clear how to do it in general, in the NTK regime, it's quite easy. For example, for the n times n weight matrix W, we have the following inequality that hold with high probability, where this step here uses a well-known bound on the Gaussian initialism matrix W0, and also the stability of the weights during training in the NTK regime that we proved. Using these properties for all the weight matrices, we get the following bounds for finite yet large n. We still have here dependency on n that is not upper bounded, but this is not surprising because we show that the network can fit any training data in the NTK regime under mild assumptions. And thus, the slope of the output is not bounded by a constant number. To get rid of the dependency on N, we can examine the ratio between the bounds for typical value of one of the hyperparameters. We get this ratio, from which we see two things. First, for a moderate value of alpha, which recalled it's the weight of the that multiplies the residual block, we get that the bound for ResNet is smaller, which hints that its output is smoother than MLP. Second, for such small enough alpha, increasing the number of layers decreases the ratio, which hints that the smoothness distinction would increase. We now turn to compare the smoothness of the ResNet and MLP NTKs, both by visualizing the kernels and their interpolation, and by quantitatively measuring an approximated L2 norm of the second derivative of the interpolation. This quantity is computed as follows, and exact details on it can be found in the paper. Recall again the empirical results that we got and I presented before, outside the NTK regime for five nonlinear layers. And here is what we get with the NTK, and you can observe the similarity. In the left, we present the kernels themselves, the NTK themselves, for MLP in blue and ResNet with different value of alpha. In the middle and the right, we present regression results for two cases. You can see that decreasing alpha yields a smoother ResNet NTK with smoother interpolation results. For alpha equals one, the ResNet NTK is more similar to the MLP NTK, but even then it appears smoother. And the quantitative measures agree with the visual results. When we increase the number of layers, we get the following NTK results. for the MLP, increasing L, the number of hidden layers, clearly reduces the smoothness. For the ResNet, this effect is moderate for alpha equals 1 and almost unseen for alpha equals 0.1. Again, the quantitative measure agrees with the visual results. Let us conclude our work. We developed the NTK for a ResNet model and proved its stability during training with gradient descent. When both networks use ReLU activations, our smoothness study showed that ResNet, especially with moderately attenuated residual blocks, yields smoother interpolations than MLP. Yet, note that when the activation function is smooth, the different NTKs have similar smoothness, as we show in our paper. More technical details and numerical results for multivariate functions appear in the paper. Thank you.